Welcome to this edition of the program CEOs Talk Business at the Marina. Today, my name is Hope Orivri. It's my pleasure to welcome our guest today on the program, Dr. Olisa Bakoba. His senior partner, Olisa Bakoba Lega. He'll be talking with us today on the issue of trade facilitation at the nation's ports. Doctor, you're welcome on the program.
Thank you.
Now we want to talk about trade facilitation at the nation's ports. And we know the vital role that trade facilitation plays in trade. And we have heard you talk over some time now about Nigeria being able to generate as much as 7 trillion naira from the ports or the maritime industry. There have been hiccups why Nigeria has not been able to hit the bullseye in that regard. What are these issues? Do for us a review so we can see what they are. And I want you to take into consideration the role of the Nigeria Customs. Let's look at implementation of the trade policies, and then on the part of the trading public as well. We know over time the customs have talked about compliance and some other issues at the port.
Well, it's a broad question you pose, and my answer will be in the context of policy failure, the fact that the government of Nigeria and its competent states are not as attuned to the issue of policy as one would like. But interestingly, this is a very, very interesting year. Depends on how you look at it. COVID has made a lot of people think. I'm surprised. COVID has made people to think. Disruption has taken place. There are new ways of doing things. Hotels are out of business. So what you would do as a business person is to think through, how can I generate revenue? President Buhari just announced his 2021 budget with a deficit. The Minister of Finance is saying that we're going into a recession in the third quarter, already in the third quarter, beginning of the third quarter. So all the macroeconomic and fiscal policy parameters look negative. And when people are challenged, they tend to do better. When Nigeria was awash with cash, Gowon, as head of state back in the 70s, once said, I don't know what to do with money. I'm sure President Buhari would say, oh, I wish you can give it to me now. So because we are now strapped for cash, there's a lot of policy thinking taking place. And I was happy to see President Buhari in his ministerial retreat charge the ministers to be up and doing. He needed to see more coordination, more harmonization. He needed to see novel issues. And so I said, finally. I've been talking about a lot of these things for 30 years, some 40. And so any country that doesn't understand how to shape its trade policy is not ready to do business. So Nigeria is, as the former Emir of Kano rightly pointed out, a dumping ground. People just dump. So no one is inspired to produce. Nobody. And if you're not inspired to produce, then you're going to be poor.
Let me just chip in here. You said people just dump. Are we fine with the land borders being shut for?
Absolutely. What are we talking about? Absolutely. Absolutely. It is a very big misconception that because we are in ECOWAS, or I'm a French citizen, that if I arrive at the English border, I'll just walk in. Wouldn't I show my passport? So the only problem with the trade policy in respect of the border closure was that they called it the wrong name. The proper name in trade is border enforcement. And when goods are run from whatever to Cotonou, Cotonou is the port of final destination. So there's no further exportation. So the exportation of whatever is coming into Nigeria from Cotonou is illegal, even by ECOWAS protocols.
But the WTO made provisions rather for goods even when they get to the borders, and then beyond the borders, there are some provisions.
Yeah, but not if not if the goods are designated for a particular country as final destination. That's the end of the trade transaction. But if I now take it on from Cotonou to Lagos, that's smuggling. which the protocol doesn't allow, which is what is happening. So the goods destined for Cotonou are in transit to Nigeria, and therefore we're then entitled to apply relevant trade remedies. Of course, one of the biggest tools to control trade that the nation should have is called the Trade Remedies Legislation, which means you're able to assign duty or tariffs or quotas to protect your own markets. The fact that we have trade facilitation is not an answer to have an open border. You can see what Trump is doing to the Chinese. If trade was such a sexy thing, why is Britain leaving the European Union? Because it doesn't pay them, according to them. So the importance of trade is to first of all promote your country. If trade does not, then you use tariffs, quotas, and high walls to stop it.
Okay, so for now, yes. How long more should this border closure continue?
To the extent that Nigeria needs it, one. To the extent that we're not violating any protocols, we're not. If the Benin Republic now realizes that they are doing the wrong thing and want to do the right thing, then they'll be paying us duty. Right now, they're taking all the duty. They'll be paying us because their country is simply a country of throughput. It's coming to us. So we now receive duty, but we don't. We don't. What they do is they smuggle it. They compromise the Nigerian border authorities, and things are smuggled. The customs of Nigeria gets zilch revenue.
Okay, so what happens now to the AFCFTA? That's the African.
It's a tricky question. You know, trade is tricky. It's a tricky question. That's why we have not signed. So we're thinking through what's the best angle. Trade for a country that is very weak domestically in terms of production is not a very sexy thing.
What should Nigeria be doing?
I'll not be very keen to sign for now. I will not be very keen because we need to grow our industries.
And then what do we do to at least grow, help development of SMEs?
Well, not only SMEs, everything. So we now need to have a conversation about how do we build our natural resources. So we do so by looking at what the Minister of Finance is doing. She now has a revenue growth initiative, which has a lot of components. One is revenue generation, which is good, job creation, which is good, growing the economy, which is good, ease of process, which is good, cost of governance, which is good, wastage and leakage. All this combined means that there will now be money to make people begin to invest in the country by small little things like farming. I've got a lot of clients now who are looking for crowdfunding to do farming, small little cottage industries, and that's how it starts. Then we begin to grow, but we need to have strong economic policy support from the government. I mean, how can Nigeria, as big as it is, the two most important tools that facilitate trade, a vessel and an aircraft, we don't have one. We don't have a single vessel. Ethiopia, that went through famine and war, has come up to be Africa's largest carrier. One day, I was at the Addis Ababa airport. Five aircraft took off to Nigeria. Enugu, Lagos, Kano, Kaduna, and some other place. Five aircraft.
So why has it been so difficult for Nigeria to have at least a national fleet, seaborne?
Resource costs, oil, cheap money. If you have cheap money, don't think. That's why I'm happy that finally oil receipts are going down so that we can think. Because South Korea has no oil, Singapore has no oil, Japan has no oil or resources, but they're doing very well. Singapore has one of the largest fleets of vessels. So how can we that produce things with all the importation not have a single vessel or aircraft? It doesn't make sense. So in order to support trade facilitation, we need to build these things. Ethiopian Air and Emirates have now gone to Lome, a small hungry country, and giving them enough money and bought their airport. So it's now a hub So you can generate a flight from Ethiopia or Dubai via Lome. Via Lome. We are the ones who ordinarily are the natural port of call. We are bypassed.
Okay, now the trading public lately has cried out that the Nigeria Customs Service is like more concerned about revenue generation than trade facilitation.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about customs processes.
Yes.
In terms of goods for cargo to be cleared,
yes,
released, and then movement of the goods, mm-hmm, from the port. We know what Apapa port is, mm-hmm, here, mm-hmm, out. I mean, how can we reconcile this?
Well, it's for them to just do the right thing. I mean, I'm shocked that Colonel Hamid would say that since the border was closed, they are now getting about 12 to 15 billion extra a day, and not worry about, you know, improving facilitation so they can balance both. No, revenue is crucial. They can't dispute that. There's nothing wrong with customs making money, you know, for the government. But they also need to enhance their skills. The fact that there is manual inspection in the ports, you know, kind of delays it causes, and that's why our ports are not attractive. 8 out of 10 containers coming to the Central West African region for Nigeria, but they rather divert to other ports and then begin to smuggle. So the only way to do it is to make sure that trade facilitation, you know, framework is super efficient. And if it's super efficient, you will very well know that Apapa is in dire need of massive infrastructure uplift. It needs rails, it needs good road network. Even though I have told the MD of the Nigerian Post Authority that the Apapa port is technically finished.
So what are some of the solutions that you can provide?
A multimodal transportation system is so easy. A multimodal transportation system. You know, when the colonials first came, they understood how to export our rich natural resources. So they built, now we have NIWA, the National Inland Waterways Authority. Then we had the Colonial Inland Waterways Authority, made up of 44 ports, inland ports. Do you know that from Ondo River to Port Harcourt, taking cocoa, back then was only 3.5 hours? Do you know that there was a massive port in Ihiala running into Port Harcourt, River Niger? All these ports have collapsed. So we're unable to move things around. That's why you have the glut and of containers in Apapa. Now that the NIWA guys have operationalized, even though I'm not sure, the Onitsha port, it takes 6 hours from One to Onitsha port. But it takes about 2 months from Lagos to Onitsha, the same container. So you can see what trade facilitation will do and infrastructure. But we don't have it. We have at least 3 or 4 deep sea ports, but they're not being constructed. So I'm hoping that as government revenue is tighter and tighter on the oil side, it will increase the policy thinking about trade facilitation.
Okay, fine. So I mean, as a lineup, just kindly give us your thoughts, the things that Nigeria should begin to do to address this, the nucleus of this problem.
You mean just trade or generally?
Generally.
Thinking.
Most interested in trade.
Thinking. That's the first thing. Thinking.
Okay.
Thinking. You've got to think. You've got to have a concept. You've got to absolutely think through issues and have a blueprint. And that thinking takes place at the ministerial level. You know, the typical way government runs is to split it into about 3 or 4 modules. The thinkers are not the doers. So the thinkers pass it on to what they call executive agencies. We call them parastatals. So the parastatals deliver what the thinkers have done. So a minister, say Minister of Transport.
Yeah.
It is not fashionable business to run around the country and get ragged, or the work of Amechi to pop up in different railway stations. That's not his job. There's the Nigerian Railway Corporation. And I'm so happy that my grandfather's brother was the first Nigerian MD of the railways. So back then, it is his job to grow the railways, because the thinkers are the Amichis and the Fasholas. When they produce a blueprint, we want this sort of network of roads. It's not for Fasholas to now go and start operationalizing it. He's got FEMA, he's got all those groups. That's their job. Then, so that's the second level, the executive agency. The third level are the regulators, those who ensure compliance. So if you have these three well understood, then you find government is going seamlessly. Then I read the economic sustainability plan, which is the new thing that took over from the ERGP, and that plan continues to make the same error of government being a businessman. Government is not a businessman, government is a thinker. So if you look at that document, government is to build 300,000 houses. It's not his job. Government is to buy 5,000 solar panels. That's not his job. Government creates the environment. And I hope that when time comes for the national fleet, government will not start buying planes and aircraft. Look at Airpeace. Look at ARIC. If ARIC and Airpeace had been supported by a Fly Nigeria Act,
so it should be a PPP thing.
Private sector. Not PPP. Private sector.
Completely private sector.
In America, where I got the Cabotage Act from,
yeah.
The Cabotage Act ring fences who will work in our coastal waters. That's Nigeria. We don't need Nigerian government to own ships to work in our waters. We need for the Nigerian government to say, this is only for Nigerians. Then, if I were a Nigerian vessel owner, the attraction of cargo in that space enables me to access credit, and I get the work done. So until this is well understood, the thinkers are the ministers, the executive agencies are the parastatals, the regulators are like the NCC, and then the private sector carries the bulk. They take the risks. In America, government owns nothing. They don't even own, they don't even have a minister of information. So we must make government very efficient. Then that energy is released for the private sector to thrive. The modern way of building ports now is entirely private. But what I can see from the plan is for government to build A, B, C, D, E port. For the same government to provide 774 primary care clinics across Nigeria. It's impossible. But if you empower local doctors to say, look, here is how we will do it, then they will do it. The NHS in the United Kingdom doesn't own all the hospitals. They don't own all the schools. This ASU issue, I would resolve it by leaving universities. Government has no business in universities. I will absolutely resolve it by leaving universities, leaving schools, giving schools back to the missionaries, so that my budget will shrink, and rather than spend 10 trillion, I will spend 2 trillion, because I'm not doing anything that concerns business. Because civil society is there, the churches are there, I have enough businessmen like Dangote to flourish and develop the country. All that these guys want is stability of policy. The policy is stable so that they don't somersault. So if I now go take money to buy 10 aircraft, then tomorrow government will somersault and say, oh, we are now going to start up 10 Nigeria Airways owned by government. Government has no business in business. Then you will find the private sector thinking. And this trade issue you're talking about will be easy. Nigerians want, a private sector man wants to make money, but he's not allowed. That's the problem.
We thank you once again for giving us these great insights. I think we have seen that it is beyond just talking trade facilitation, that policy and governance, because policies are made by government,
yeah.
Governance plays
yeah.
a very crucial role.
Yeah.
When we talk about
yeah.
Trade facilitation.
Yeah.
Thank you once
yeah.
again, Dr.
No problem.
Akuba, for speaking
pleasure.
With us.